But I want to start talking about what today represents on the church calendar, because today is the 499th anniversary of the beginning of the Protestant Reformation. The Protestant Church celebrates every year on October 31st, or generally the Sunday thereof, about that time, the nailing of Martin Luther's 95 theses on the All Saints Church door in Wittenberg, Germany. Okay? Does anybody have any idea what the 95 theses was and why it meant so much and what happened as a result of it? Does anybody know what it is? Not you, Brother David. The 95 theses were 95 questions that Martin Luther posed to the Catholic Church. Years before Martin Luther, there were men such as Huss and men such as Philip Agrippa, who were put to death because they challenged the church, because they tried to teach a new doctrine. Well, Martin Luther wasn't put to death because of the way he went about it, and because it was not God's time for such a thing as that to happen. It was time for the church to change. And we need to understand that during these 95 theses, he called into question many of the doctrines of the Catholic Church. Because what was happening in Germany, remember, Germany was the war ground of Europe. How many of you know that? All the wars of Europe took place on German soil. They were a poor country. They were a farming country. And they had little industry. So when it came time to have a war between warring nations and what have you, they would literally go into Germany and do their battles in Germany because it wouldn't affect their homelands. And Germany was torn by war for centuries and centuries, and therefore they were a poor people constantly having to rebuild their cities and their towns and their villages and what have you. And therefore, when the Catholic Church decided to go to Germany to start extracting money from the people to get folks out of purgatory, which were called indulgences, in other words, you could buy your loved one's way out of purgatory, which, by the way, there is no such thing as purgatory. There is nowhere in Scripture it speaks of purgatory. Purgatory was something that was made up by the church to exact money from people. You know, Dan Dower tells a story of a Catholic priest who went to a widow. This is a true story. Went to a widow to extract money from her because, you know, she hadn't been there, she hadn't been given her tithe, and he told the widow, he said, you know, your husband's almost out of purgatory. If you pay for just a few more masses, we'll get him out. And she said, well, how much of him is left in there? And he said, well, about one leg. And she said, well, which leg is it? He says, left leg. She said, oh, that's okay, because that's a fake leg. We don't need it. True story. Am I right, Daniel? Okay, this is how bad it had become years ago, but yet it still happens even today. Okay, and Martin Luther said, we can't have this because the Scripture does not speak anything of this. He said, sola scriptura, Scripture alone. And Martin Luther, putting those 95 theses on the Wittenberg door, was a different approach, because the other men who had come after the Pope, who had come after the doctrines of the church, attacked them through doctrine, attacked them through less formal means. But in the day and time when he nailed the 95 theses, does anybody have any idea why did he nail this paper, this huge paper, why did he nail it to the door of the church? How many of you knew you were coming for a history lesson today? Why did he nail it to the church? Because the church door was the advertising center of the community. Okay? They would often, because this area, it was a university, it was a college. And whenever someone did a theological work, they would nail it to the door for other people to give opinion on their work. Okay? Well, Martin wrote this beautiful paper, this huge paper, asking all these questions because he wanted dialogue. He wanted the church to respond. And therefore, the church could not just simply come after him and kill him because the people could read it. It was in German. It wasn't in Latin. So the people began to see that, you know, hey, here's a priest asking the same questions we're asking, and they couldn't just come after him, because what would happen to the Pope's popularity in Germany if they killed the guy who was asking the questions that was on all their minds? Kind of like what happens here in the United States. You know, when we start asking the questions, what happens to the person that's asking the questions? They just kind of disappear, don't they? The media kind of turns them off, and somehow or another they just go away. How did that happen? But today we know that God in his time knew it was now time for the church to change. So the Lord allowed this to transpire because everything is in God's time. And you and I need to understand that. Please open your Bibles to Ecclesiastes 3. We were already there this morning in song, and we're going there now in word and in deed. Because I think it is so important for us to understand that the book of Ecclesiastes, while it can sometimes be hard to understand, the book of Ecclesiastes and the book of Lamentations can both be a little hard to understand. God has a message here for us, and I want us to be able to understand that message and know just what is going on. From the book of Ecclesiastes, we're going to be in the third chapter. We're going to start in the first verse. It says, "There is an appointed time for everything, and there is a time for every event under heaven. A time to give birth, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to uproot what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw stones and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace and a time to shun embracing. A time to search and a time to give up as lost. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear apart and a time to sew together. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. What profit is there to the worker from that in which he toils? I have seen the task which God has given the sons of men with which to occupy themselves. He has made everything appropriate in its time. He has also set eternity in their hearts, yet so that man will not find out the work which God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to rejoice and to do good in one's lifetime. Moreover, that every man who eats and drinks sees good in all his labor. It is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will remain forever. There is nothing to add to it, and there is nothing to take from it. For God has so worked that men should fear him. Blessed be the word of our Lord. Amen." The point I want to make here is that God knows the times that we are in. And God is in control of all those things. God knows what is happening. He knows where we are. Okay? He knows the condition of our soul. He knows the condition of our lives. And he is concerning himself about them. He tells us in his word, "I will never leave you nor..." So God is always there. God is in control of time. I think it's amazing because, you know, God is actually outside of time. We are in time. God is in eternity. God has created time for us. It's not for him. He knows we need to have time to live this life. And that is what we're all trying to figure out. What is this life about? Amen? Where is it going to end up? What am I supposed to be? What's my purpose? wah-wah, and the questions just keep coming, don't they? God knows what's going on. And when we think of what happened in the Reformation, okay, I want you to think what happened in the Reformation. Our world has not seen such change since the coming of Christ. Because the church, the Catholic Church at that point in time, and I'm not picking on anybody, this is historic fact, the Catholic Church admits it, and they've apologized for it many, 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 many times. But the Catholic Church at that point in time had become so politically corrupt that the greatest thieves and robbers were the cardinals, the bishops, the Pope himself, all those in power. Because you see, the church had risen to such power in our world that it literally controlled kings. Without the Pope's blessing, you could not become the king of a nation. The Pope had to bless you. Okay? Hence, England removed itself from the Catholic Church and actually started its own church with its own bishops. And who ran that church? Does anybody know? The government, the king. Yeah, exactly. Because the church had become so corrupt. But even the Church of England was corrupt because the kings were corrupt. Anytime you have people involved in something, what happens? Corruption. Corruption. Why? Because of sin. And we're going to see why that happens here in just a little while. Today, I'm going to be painting some broad strokes that over the next couple weeks, next 3 weeks, as a matter of fact, we're going to be painting them in. And we're going to end with the greatest reality of all, and you'll have to wait 3 weeks to find out what that is. Because all of this combines to reach a certain point in time, God's time, for something extraordinary to happen. And that something extraordinary involves each and every one of us. But during this time, we need to live our lives. So as we are living our lives, the things that happen to us only happen as God allows them to happen at their proper time. Now, how many of you like the idea of knowing that your suffering God knows all about, and He has said, yep, that's what I want for you right now? How does that make you feel? That makes you all happy and joyful that, oh, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you for this trial. Thank you for this tribulation, right? You're all clamoring to thank God for that. You're all clamoring. You want to thank God for the good things in your lives, right? We also need to thank God for the trials in our lives. Why? Because it's through those trials that we grow. It's through those trials that we are changed. It is through those trials that we begin to understand some of what is being written here. I want you to look back in your Bibles, and there are several things that I want us to look at. Look at verse 1 in chapter 3. Look at verse 1 in chapter 3. And it so amazes me because it's how the song here today began, and it's how we need to realize this stuff. It says, there is an appointed time for everything, and there is a time for every event under heaven. In other words, God is telling us that there is nothing He doesn't know about. What does that speak to? That speaks to God's sovereignty, doesn't it? You know, one of the things that I think is most amazing, do you know why we go through some of the trials that we go through in our lives? Very simple reason. Because God is allowing us to understand that He is sovereign. During our times of struggle, how many of us look at God and say, why? And I know you're all going to be pious and say, oh, I never ask God why, liar. Always. We do ask why. Because we don't understand. But you see, God says something else. Turn to verse 14. Verse 11. Please understand this. He has made everything appropriate in its time. Period. Now, how many of you out there have had some things happen in your life that just aren't appropriate? You look at them and you say, that should never have happened. I can look at my own life and I can say that there are things that happened to me that should never have happened. Okay? Being molested from the age of 8 years old to the age of 14 should never have happened, but it happened. It was inappropriate. But God says, what did he say there? He has made everything appropriate in its time. Now, does that mean that God said that that sin that was happening was good? No. What does that say? That says God knew that sin was going to happen, and we're going to get into that here in just a little while. God knew that sin was going to happen, so when it happened, because I too am a sinner, saved by grace, and at that time I was not in Christ, so therefore God could not stop the sin from happening because I too am a sinner and the person who did it was a sinner. God says, however, I'm going to redeem that time. Because you see, that's one thing that we need to understand. Because God is outside of time, God can redeem time. God can change what is perceived of time because he is outside of time. He exists in a reality that is beyond anything we can understand because he is able to take us in our minds back in time that we can reevaluate what was going on here and turn that bad thing into a lesson for our good. Because God worketh all things to good, right? For everybody. No, only to those who love him. I did not love God when this happened to me, but when I did begin to love God and learn from God, he was able to take me back in time, mentally, spiritually, and heal my being and get me to learn some things about that that have helped me to become the pastor that I am today, looking at where people were hurting and how God can affect time. Do you know that the Lord God himself, not being constrained in time, is able to go back and heal any and everything in your life that ever affected you? But you have to allow him. Because you see, the church during the Reformation had made centuries of atrocities under the Catholic rule. But through the Protestant Reformation, God was able to restore the church to a health that it had never known before. And yet, even within that health, we found so much division that how many denominations do we now have in the Protestant faith? I can't even count them all. But today, there has been a resurgence, even in the body of Christ as it is divided denominationally. That's why we're not a denomination. We're an independent church. We simply say the Bible is the Word of God. Amen? It is the rule and authority for life. Amen? And the only way to salvation is through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen? Because that's the truth. You can't change it. We don't need a denomination that's going to tell us what we can believe and what we can't believe. God's already given us what we are to believe and not believe. Amen? Amen. And that in his time. Because how many of you were righteous 10 years ago? How many of you were righteous 15 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 60 years ago? Some of us as much as 80 years ago. We weren't. But by the grace of God, where do we stand now? In the righteousness of Christ. Amen? Amen. And in this time, God is here to heal us and bring us that hope that each and every one of us desires. Because you see, when we begin to understand this reality that is followed by verse 11a, look at 11b. For he has also set eternity in the hearts of men. Okay? That's the way the NIV reads. I like the way it reads, but it says pretty much the same thing here. He has also set eternity in their hearts so that men will not find out the works which God has done from the beginning even to the end. Because one of the things you and I need to understand is God has literally set eternity in our hearts. Why do we concern ourselves with time? Because we understand that there's something far greater than the moment we're in, don't we? We understand that there is something out there that is far bigger than all of this, and that is because God has set eternity in our hearts. God has allowed us to understand that when we look at life, there's a reason why we want to excel. There's a reason why we want the good, the best for everybody. And it so amazes me because something else is flying in the face of it. And God knows that too. Turn in your Bibles to Romans 1. Turn in your Bibles to Romans 1. We're going to begin in verse 18 from Romans 1. It says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident to them." That's God setting eternity in our hearts. That when we look upon this world, this is God's grace to every human being, okay? How does it apportion out? "For since the creation of the world, His invisible attributes, His eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse. There is no man on the face of the earth, no man who has ever existed or ever will exist, that cannot look at this world and know that there is a God, that there is a designer." Okay? You know, I've heard it said, and many of you have, that you can't just take a bunch of Lego pieces, throw them into the air, and all of a sudden it forms something, right? But they want us to believe that about our universe, that something exploded, and from an explosion, all of this came into being. Now, I love it because they take out their magic wand of time, and they wave their hands, and they add billions of years to it because, well, it would take billions of years for this to happen. Do you know what the odds of that are? They are astronomical. Mathematically, you and I would have to figure for the rest of our lives plus 10 other lives to get to the end of that equation. Fortunately, someone has done it for us. It is like 1 to 109 to the 30,000th power. Okay? That's a number so big, as it was expressed to me, that it would literally fill the Library of Congress with numbers. If you took all the books in the Library of Congress and just started writing digits, it would fill every book in the Library of Congress. That's how big, that's how astronomical those odds are. And yet, our world says, yep, that's exactly what happened. Because we look at time the same way they do, that it has always existed. No, God has always existed. Time was created for us, and our world was given an appearance of age. We understand that from Genesis 1. Because God made the trees, and He made the animals, and when He made them, they were ready and able to produce fruit and bring forth their own kind. Because everything on this planet was created with the appearance of age, because God's able to do that. Because God's in control of time. You see, He's outside of it. But when we begin to understand the realities of what God is telling us here, we can understand and we can know. However, there's a problem with us and with the world. What is that problem? "For even though they knew God, they did not honor Him as God or give thanks, but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of incorruptible God for an image in the form of one corruptible man and of birds and of four-footed animals and crawling creatures. Therefore, God gave them over in their lusts of their hearts to impurity so that their bodies would be dishonored among them. For they exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshiped the served and the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them over to degrading passions, for the women exchanged the natural function for that which was unnatural, and in the same way also the men abandoned their natural function of the woman and burned in their desire toward another man. And when men committed indecent acts and received in their own persons the due penalty of their error. You see, God allowed the delusions of our own bodies, of our own minds, of our own entrappings to keep us, to trap us, okay? To trap our entire world. I think it's amazing because one of the things that I look at as a pastor when I think about time, because God says we are going to suffer. God says that we are going to find ourselves in a way that is going to stress us out. How many of you feel stressed out? For those of you who aren't, praise Jesus. I'm glad you aren't stressed. Because I'll tell you right now, in saying that, you're about to head into one. Because the evil one does not like to let us alone. Amen? Because he knows if he can get us distracted, if he can get our minds on something else, we're not going to be involved with God. And he does that so well in our world because of the very thing that we just read. He gives these people over. He gave our world over to delusions of its own self-grandeur. We think that everything that is important in life is to build this world up, to make a name for ourselves, and to create a kingdom in which we are raised up. Okay? That's what we're taught from grade school on up. You may not agree with that, but that's the truth. That's what we teach our kids in school. Of course, now we're teaching them some very different things because now we're teaching them that our society is in control of everything and our society tells us what's right and what's wrong. Okay? Because we have become so depraved in our thinking that is it any wonder that these things happen to us? When I think about where we are and where life is going, you know, I have had several of you over the last 3 weeks, and I need to tell you where this sermon came from, where this series came from. How many of you, you know, you get to watch Pastor and you understand the things that are happening in my life? This year, my mom died in April. 2 months later, my sister died in June. 2 months later, we ended up putting down our dog and our cat in the same week. So in 6 months, it was death after death after death. And now even poor Miss Arlene has gone on, you know, another very important person in my life. Well, when we were on vacation, I was burying my dog and my cat. And I had dug a 4-foot by 3-foot by 3-foot hole to put the two of them in. And I had just finished the hole, and it just started to rain. And I was standing in the hole, sitting on the edge, and I just said, Lord, this just isn't right. This just isn't right. I said, Father, I don't understand. I said, you know, my mom, and 2 months later, my sister, and 2 months later, my dog and my cat. I said, Lord, I can't take any more of this. Sitting there with my feet in the hole. Sitting there with my feet in the grave. Please catch the picture God's painting. With my feet in the grave of this life. He said to me, Rich, don't you trust me? And there I sat. I said, Lord, I trust you implicitly. I just don't understand. And he said, yeah. Isn't that what the scripture says? He has set eternity in our hearts, but so that men may not know. You see, God doesn't want us to understand everything. He wants us to learn. He wants us to grapple with this life and understand that there is something far beyond it, that there is something greater than this life. And to that end is what we're to be working towards. That's why Jesus gloried in the cross, scorning its shame. Isn't that what we're told in the book of Hebrews? For the joy that's set before Him, how many of us look at death as a joy that sets before us? Jesus died a miserable death for you and I, but it was God's apportioned time for the Son of God to die for us, that we would know the hope. Don't you just love how our Sunday school lessons turn right into... God amazes me all the time, but that's because He knows our time. And He knows where we are and what we're studying. For some of you here, you've been saying to me over these last couple months, I just got an email from one of our dear saints that all this stuff is pouring out on them and they fear and all this stuff. That's the evil one. But God wants us to teach us through it. Please remember that. Because there's two important principles that we need to learn through these things. There is a reason that our time is filled with struggle and strife. There is a reason that these things happen in our life, because there is something beyond it that we need to understand is greater than it. And that is God Himself. Okay? What are the two principles that God wants us to learn? Why do we suffer through this stuff? Why was I sitting there with my feet in this hole? And God said, "Don't you trust me?" And I said, "Yes, Lord, I do trust you." He said, "Then I want you to think about something." He said, "Here you are." He said, "You lost your mom, you lost your sister, you lost a dog, you lost a cat." He said, "Do you know how many billions of people I've lost?" Wow. Billions of people who have not come to know the Lord. They're lost to Him. I never thought of that. I mean, I have, but not on that scale of things. Billions. And we only have a short time. You know, we think about it, and I want you all to think about it. How long have you been alive, folks? I know Miss Eve is 34. Just found that out today. Huh? Didn't I say Eva? I thought I did. Miss Eva is 34. I'm 53. If by reason, I have 31 years left, okay? If by reason, and that's if the rapture doesn't happen, we think that's a lot of time, but that's only because this body wears out. The reality is, it's gone. It is but a mist. That's what the men found out at hunting camp. Our life is but a mist. It's here today and gone tomorrow. Because eternity is forever. But we have this short period of time to learn. We have this short period of time to begin to understand what it means to have eternity set in our hearts. There's a reason why we struggle with all the things we struggle. There's a reason that this world comes against us. What are those reasons? The first reason is this. We need to remember that in our time, we are also dealing with other fallen people and a fallen world affected by sin to the point of increasing depravity. Okay? Romans 1 and 28, we just read that. And just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over. Oh, excuse me, I stopped right before that. And just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over to a depraved mind, to those things which are not proper. When we look at our world, all the things that are happening in this world are the things of that depraved mind. Men are building their kingdom, not the kingdom of God. And therefore, the depravity of this world affects us, E-F-F-E-C-T, affects us because we have been affected by sin. Now, many people would say to me, and I used to hate this, and I still do, people would come to me and they'd say, oh, Pastor, you know, this is happening in my life, and that's happening in my life. And the pious people in the church would say, well, you must have sin in your life. No kidding! But is that why this stuff is happening? No. It's happening because sin, with a capital S, a capital I, and a capital N, is in our world. And his name is Satan. And he has affected this world in such a way that all the depravity thereof falls on us. But God says, I want you to learn from this. Learn from me. The things of this world are not for you, that you have set on your heart the things of eternity. Most people, when you think about it, they're going to go into their job, and they're going to go in there, and they're going to, and I love this, I worked in the machine shop for 20 years, and I saw it every day. They went in there, they got good pay, and they wanted to do as little as they possibly could to get through their day. But we as Christians, we go into our job, and we care about our job because it's the gift of God to us. And we care about our employer because we're supposed to care about our employer. We're supposed to do the best job that we can do. So we do the best job. And the next thing you know, because we're doing the best job, we get everything dumped on us. Why? Because they know you're going to do it. So joy in it. And say, Lord, pile it on deeper and higher. Because as God does allow us to see what's really in our hearts, what we're really trying to show the people around us is that we care beyond ourselves. That we care about this company that we work for. We care about the eternality of all peoples. We care in a greater scale because God has truly set eternity on the hearts of us. That we know that this all ends in something bigger, greater than any little company, any little person, any little boss who thinks they are the end of the world. Because no person is the end of the world. Amen? Except Jesus Christ. Because when he comes, he will end the world. And we need to remember that. And that's why it hurts us so. Because we are living for Christ, but we are living for Christ in a world that hates Christ. And to those who are perishing, we are, oh, the most wonderful thing since sliced bread, right? No, the scripture says, we are the fragrance of death to those who are perishing and the fragrance of life to those who are being saved. So we need to continue letting that aroma come out of our lives. That means we got to continue to do good works. Do not give up well-doing. How easy would it be for us to just throw our hands in the air and say, oh well, and just let it all happen? In Christ Jesus, we can't do that, can we? Because Jesus says we're supposed to look at the other person as better than ourselves. We are supposed to look at that other person and have pity on them, have mercy on them, have grace on them, have compassion on them. So therefore, these things come against us. And it's nothing because you've got sin in your life. It's because there's sin in our world. And it has been added up and added up and added up. But God is in control of all time. And there's also a second reason that God allows these things to happen. And many of you don't like this. But guess what, parents? You do it all the time to your own kids. So why do you think God wouldn't do it to you? What is that one thing? God truly understands that he is training us up through discipline that we may enter into eternity in Christ Jesus, that we may become like him. Turn to 1 Timothy 4. 1 Timothy 4. Verse 8. says here, for bodily discipline is only of little profit, but godliness is profitable for all things, since it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. Okay? For bodily discipline is only of little profit, but godliness is profitable for all things, since it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. You and I need to understand that God is training us up. He has called us children, and not just somebody else's children, but His own children. He has adopted us into His family, and He has loved us to that place of life. He has loved us to the place of knowing that we are to be raised as His children. You know, I think it's so funny because when I was a kid, I used to tell my dad, when I get all grown up and I have kids, I'm never going to do the things you do. And as I got older, I saw my father come out in me. Now, hopefully only the good things. Because I would do things and it would be like, oh my Lord, I've become my dad. Not because it was a bad thing, but the things He taught me were really good things. Now, not everything He taught me, but you see, kids, I'm going to talk to you teenagers right now, okay? They're all over here. Most of them are anyway, a couple of you over there. Your parents are the best examples you will ever have of Jesus Christ. They're also the best examples you will ever have of Satan himself. Okay? You have to determine what is good and what is bad. How do you determine that? Right here. Look at this book. Read this book. Understand this book. And the things that mom and dad teach you that are good, become those things. The things that mom and dad teach you that are bad, throw them out. That's what you have to do. And then you have to teach the next generation. And the next generation teaches the next generation and the next generation. You see, we've become lulled in what we've taught our children. And we've got to switch that around. How about it, parents? That we've literally got to start raising up godly children. How about it, parents? And letting our kids understand that I'm not doing this to you to hurt you. I'm doing this because it's right. You may not like it, but that's tough. I can remember going to my mom and saying, yeah, but Tommy and Ronnie and Billy, and they all got to... And she, my mom, you know what her favorite saying was? Well, if they all jumped off a bridge, would you? The answer is, yeah, probably. Because it's what they were doing. And that's what our world has done. It has jumped off the cliff into the pit, and we're expected to follow. No, God says that we are His children and that godliness has profit. Turn in your Bibles to Philippians 3 and 10. Philippians 3 and 10. Remember, we are to be transformed through these things to Christ, right? Transforming lives to the heart of Jesus Christ. That's our vision statement, right? That's our mission statement. And may be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes from God on the basis of faith, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being conformed to His death. Blessed be the word of the Lord. Amen? Because it is in this reality, in these sufferings, Jesus suffered many things on this earth, even to the point of death. He's not asking us to die physically, but to die spiritually to self. That we put behind us the things of this world, and we shed off the shackles of this world, and we run the race which sets before us. Let us think on the people who have been the prophecy of faith in our land. This is Hebrews, folks. We need to understand that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witness. I mean, think of these men and women who suffered throughout all the ages, and God wrote their name in the book of life. and we have it here before us. Where do you think your name is getting written as you and I go through these trials and temptations? It is being written in blood in the book of life. Can I have an hallelujah to the Lord, the Lamb of our sacrifices? Amen. Brothers and sisters, this thing is working out our salvation in fear and trembling. God doesn't say work it out in comfort and PJs. Fear and trembling. It is progressive sanctification time. And God is doing a work in us. And let he who has begun a good work in you bring it on to completion in the day of Christ Jesus. Amen. Because it's his time that we're living in. It's not our time anymore. We gave it up to him the day we chose the cross of Christ. For we now live in eternity, but we're affected by a world that lives in time. Amen. So let's get over the time. Throw the clock out and remember that Christ is right there for us. I got to end this puppy. So I want you to turn to these last two scriptures, okay? Oh, before I do, I got to say this. In Hebrews 12, 7 through 11, it tells us that we are children of God. And that as we are going through this life, and I want you to write that down because I want you all to look it up. Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 7 through 11. That's where the 11 came from. Hebrews 12, 7 through 11. Because God is treating us as children. He is disciplining us. He is putting boundaries around us. You know, we look at discipline and we think we're getting smacked, right? No. Discipline means there are boundaries. There are things that we are to live in. There are ways that we are to be. And that's what our parents do. They put boundaries around us, okay? How many of you teenagers love the boundaries your parents put around you? I love your expression right now. That was just priceless. That was serious disdain. No, I hate it. But the reality is God puts those boundaries around all of us because he's treating us all like we really are, children, okay? He doesn't look at us and see our age. He doesn't see a 13-year-old and a 45-year-old. He sees a child spiritually where we are. And you know what? Some of our kids are about equal with us. How about it, parents? I mean spiritually. I'm not talking where you're going here. Because we have kids who are in the world that think they're all grown up. We've been there, done that, ain't. Those shoes don't fit, do they? Those shoes don't fit. But the reality is, as we are growing up, God puts these boundaries around us, okay? Why? Because it's his discipline. He's teaching us. It says, endure hardship as discipline, to be trained up by it, to understand that God wants to teach us something. If you can look at hardship in that manner, because then you can look on God, you call on God. You're not looking at your situation, you're looking at God. You're looking in his face. Look full in the face of Christ, okay? Look full in his marvelous face, and the things of the earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. We forget that. We sing it. Oh yeah, we'll stand up and we'll sing it. We'll even raise hands to it. But will we live it? Let us live it. Why should we live it? 2 Corinthians 4 and 16. 2 Corinthians 4 and 16. Like I said, I got to land this plane. I'm at 20,000 feet and we're coming down. 4 and 16. We're circling the airport here. Okay? Second Corinthians 4 and 13. But having the same... 4 and 13, right? No, 4 and 16, excuse me. 4, 16 through 17. Therefore, do not lose heart, but through your outer man, though your outer man is decaying, yet your inner man is being renewed day by day. For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. Wow! In other words, as we go through this life and as we are struggling and striving in this life and as we get through this stuff, not around it, not by it, not under it, through it, we are storing up for ourselves in heaven treasures that will be there for eternity, that rust nor moth doth not destroy, nor does thief break in and steal. But we are storing up for ourselves treasures in glory that last for all eternity. And God pays a dividend on those treasures. So we should not give up. We should not grow weary. We should not grow faint. But we should run in the strength of Christ Jesus. As renewed as the strength of eagles on eagles' wings. Soaring on eagles' wings. Oh my goodness, there's a picture for you, isn't it? To be above all this stuff. But right now, we're in the thick of it. But we need to remember, God's in control of the time. And right now, it's His time. It's no longer ours. And the second thing I want you to look at is John 16:33. John 16:33. This is Christ's word to us, okay? This is Jesus speaking to you, Charles. Speaking to you, Virginia. Speaking to you, Nancy. God Himself speaking to each and every one of us personally, individually. And this is what He says. These things I have spoken to you, so that in me you may have turmoil, trouble, hardship, peace in the world. Where? In the world. Here, now, while we're living. Not tomorrow, today. In this wretched place. And you will have tribulation. But take courage, I have overcome the world. We are in Him and He is in us. All this stuff that we're going through is something we're going to pass out of. It does not hold us captive. I want you to think about the people that God showed me. Billions of people that have been lost to Him. They are stuck in this depravity in hell for all eternity. All the pain and all the suffering lives on for every one of them forever. But for us who are in Jesus Christ, we have this period of time that we get to pass through to teach us the things of eternity, that people matter, that love matters, that compassion matters, that mercy matters, that justice matters, and there is something and someone far greater than us that He wants us to be part of Him. Because He says that there's three in one, right? God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. If it were not so, I'd have told you that, right? He says, the Father and I are one. And He says, now I want you to be in me. So guess what we get to be part of? That one. We get to be one with God and have that eternal nature. That's what this is all building towards. That each and every one of us will be one in Christ. May we find that truth wholly and hold it wholly in our hearts. God is not finished with us because it's not our time. But when it is our time, we'll be ready to go. Amen? And until that, then let us remember, Jesus says, I have overcome the world. And I am here to give you peace. Not from the world, but from Christ. So let's live in Christ. Amen? Let us pray. Father God, You have truly set eternity on the hearts of men and women and children Because, Lord, when we speak those words, your word there means all of us who are in Christ. So, Lord, I pray, we pray, that you would help us to understand that reality, that we would come to that knowledge of truly understanding what eternity means in our lives and how we are living it out, even here, struggling in this world because the world comes against us, but that we are to die to ourselves and our own desires and understand that there's something far greater for us to give and that you will give us the strength to do that as we submit ourselves to you and love people, love others as you have loved us and gave yourself up for us, even to death on the cross. So too, Lord, may we give up ourselves to death of self, that we may live to you in spirit and in truth. For it is in this we come, in the name of Christ Jesus, and it is in this that we go into this world to bring Christ Jesus to those who need him most. And to that we say, Lord, amen.